Over the past couple of weeks, I've spoken to Sujanya Shukla, who's the administrative editor at CHANV, which is CHHANV Foundation. And that's run with the aim of helping people more often than not, women who've been the victims of an acid attack, which is a truly disgusting, despicable, and pretty much cowardly and spiteful act. Sujanya introduced me to a number of women who've survived this kind of attack, and their incredible courage and strength is truly inspirational. Researching this topic's been a real learning curve for me, and I can't stress enough the admiration that I have for these ladies who not only carry on with their own lives, but also act as support to others who've suffered a similar fate. As you will see, these ladies are pretty incredible. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, click the like button, and share. Now, at the end of the clip, I'm going to give you some information on how you could help. And so please don't skip by and watch and learn.
I'll just give you a little overview of how this foundation got started.
Yeah.
So, back in 2013, there was a massive protest going on in the country, India, wherein there was this girl raped by a group of people. The case was called as Nirbhaya rape case, and everybody was talking about it. It was huge. It was brutal. So, a group of journalists' friends came up with this idea and this thought that nobody talks about acid attacks in India, and nobody knew what acid attacks are, and people actually didn't know, and the rules and laws here were similar to, if you go and pickpocket someone, right? There were nothing as called rules or regulations or anything, bans on acid attacks, and there were so many people attacked, and they were living just like that without any, rights. So a group of friends, mainly Alok Dixit, who is the founder of this organization and campaign, started a campaign, a very first of its kind, called Stop Acid Attacks in India back in 2013. And he started it through Facebook by, posting information about, there's this protest going on, and if you are an acid attack survivor, you can come down to Delhi and we will talk about it. And slowly and gradually, this whole campaign got, really a kind of an ignition. More and more people started joining. And this campaign led to the formulation of some PILs and formulations of some laws and rules in Supreme Court of India. It was a gradual process, of course. It was not something that just happened in few months. It was, years that took place. And after that, the team decided collectively that we should start some organization in India that will work for the rehabilitation of acid attack survivors in India. We don't call them victim because it's not their fault, and we call them fighters or survivors. So after that, they thought of, establishing an NGO, a non-governmental organization in India, which is called CHAV Foundation. And the word CHAV means shade. This organization is kind of a shade to all the acid attack survivors in India, be it male or female. So it happened like that. It was slow process, but it happened like that. And back in 2014, this organization started, CHAV Foundation. And Stop Acid Attacks, if you Google and search, this is one of the first, any campaign that has happened in India and most of the countries around, be it Pakistan or Bangladesh, there are also acid attacks happening. But after this particular, campaign, things got it, coming into the action, and people started knowing about the brutality that with the acid attacks. We wanted to be an independent organization and self-sustainable model. So we started a cafe, one of its kind. The very first that is totally run by acid attack survivors. And if you have heard, She Rose Hangout Agra and Lucknow. We have two outlets, and that is one of its kind. You'll never see any acid attacks, community starting a cafe. So this happened. Girls from a background where they are not very educated, because post-attack, their body goes a lot. Mentally, they are traumatized. Education and all comes to a halt. So all these things, we planned a kind of a rehabilitation model where they can actually learn things, they can get education, they can earn, which will bring empowerment in themselves, and they can feel, welcomed. to a society, because attacker's perspective is to actually destroy a girl's life or a man's life, because society will not accept. They isolate. After the attack, what happens? Yeah. They isolate themselves. Nobody bothers. People sometimes, you know, families, you know, they debunk them and they ask them to leave the houses, because that, you know, a post-attack, there are a lot of surgeries that requires a lot of amount, you know, huge amount of medical, plastic surgery, constructive surgeries. Mm. Sometimes they have to actually, in India, sometimes, you know, they're coming from a background where there is no medical facilities or the hospitals are not properly made. So they have to travel a lot and it requires a lot of funds and a lot of efforts as well. So this organization particularly works for education of the acid attack survivors. They also give them employment and also they work on their mental health. So these and legality also. We work for their, they get legal justice and something like that. So we work on that and medical treatment. So these are the 4 or 5 basic areas where we work in. We also have one more project similar as Shiro's Hangout, which is a gift story. It is an online gifting venture, again, totally run by acid attack survivors. And what we do here, we actually skill train acid attack survivors based on their interest. And then we put it up on the website and people can buy it from there.
What's the most common reason for an acid attack?
It is mostly because of the jilted lovers that throw acid on the girls, those who cannot, like, they can't woo them or marry them. So that's the case.
What's the history of these attacks? How long have they been going on?
Actually, if you dig into the fact, it's happening, and mostly in the West countries. Most people do not know, in the Western part of the, I'm talking about the Western culture and Western part of the country, like in America or London or somewhere. Mm. And it came down here in India. It's happening since 90s, and people are throwing acids, and they don't know. Like it has become a part of a criminal, weapon kind of a thing that people are using freely still. In India now, there is complete ban on acid sale, but there are vendors who are selling acid, and they are in lockdown. I just want to give you an overview. There's this woman named Tuna, and she was acid attacked badly. What they did, they threw a bucket of acid on her, and which in return, what happened? She is completely, like, 90%. She got burned. Her children got burned, and her sister got burned. So it's a huge, like, in lockdown, this happened. So I would say it's very bad as well, because still we are trying so much to control all these things. We did brought some changes in the, you know, like, people are very welcoming. They don't ask what has happened, because all the trauma, all the misery has come down straight to their face. Everybody can see that. So this is the only crime, I think this is the only crime that goes on in your life and that stays with you throughout the life. Like, for example, there are rape, I'm not comparing at all, don't get me wrong, but there are rape victims, they rape survivors, or there are, any other survivors, they might start their life in a new way. But here, for the acid attack survivors, everything is on the face and body, and it's quite visible. So wherever they go, wherever they, meet new people also, this is obvious that they will ask what has happened to you, right? Mm. So everything comes down to, circulates and comes down to the same fact that they are acid attack survivors. Mm. So this is the story.
Yeah. You mentioned that the crime is treated almost like pickpocketing. So what are the punishments for acid attacks?
This is what we were fighting for, because there were no rules. So now there are certain sections for acid attacks, and there are legal, like, we can come down to the court, and there are 10, like, any attacker can get 10 years jail, and there are certain amount of compensation that he has to give. But again, I mean, this is something that cannot change their life. It's just that, okay, and sometimes what happens? They are from rich background, the attackers, and they get easy bail, and they roam freely. It's easy for them. But once you're acid attacked, their immunity system, destroys completely, because they go to so many surgeries. Their skins, sometimes the skin has been taken from the legs, or maybe, the back and something. So there, it comes down to a lot of problems. It is very, very traumatic. when you have education in hand, I think that brings the empowerment, that brings the, resilience and courage that I can make decisions of my life. So we are believing in that and we are constantly working for that. And thank God we have certain supporters and volunteers who are supporting. These days we have been, we launched this campaign, Support Sheroes, and yeah, people are donating to us and people are, constantly reaching out to us. And we are also promoting this campaign to more and more people throughout the country and globe so that people can come and help us financially as well. Because now the table has turned and total amount of the revenue comes now from donation because the cafes have been shut.
What kind of help is out there for the survivors, psychologically, mentally?
Yeah, so what happens, there's a detailed information I'll give. What happens, if you'll talk to most of the survivors, what they say is, when I came into Shiro's or when I came to Cha Foundation, people were like, just like me, I got a community who was just like me, and nobody was judging me, nobody was asking anything, they were not pointing out that why you have this scar on face, why you have this particular, burn or something. So they got an environment and atmosphere where they can actually feel themselves. Everybody was saying, there were so many survivors talking to them like a normal girl. Nobody was asking. Nobody was making faces. And especially here, because it's, they get a systematic environment wherein everybody treats them with a cordial behavior. We actually give some time to let them decide what they actually want to do, whether they want to go for gift story, skill training, whether they want to study, whether they want to actually, take part in Shiro's happening and working. So this is the kind of a detailed work that happens. And obviously we have certain mental counselors, we have certain therapists who are in touch with this organization and working as a volunteers, and definitely they give the sessions to all these survivors. And this happens as a constant and continuous kind of a procedure that happens. And especially the one thing when I, came into the organization, I took interviews of certain survivors. There was this girl named Nagma, and she told me that when I was going through the reconstructive surgery, what I liked about, Shiro's and what I liked about this cafe was that most of the girls were like me, physically and mentally as well. So I think that helps them. That's the one thing that helps, apart from, mental counseling and therapy.
You mentioned there are male victims, also male survivors too. Is there a difference between the mental sort of coping and dealing with an attack?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, see, for females, again, in India, I have mentioned, but here we have a patriarchal society. For girl, you have to get married, you have to start a family, you have to raise children, and face is one of the entire, you have to have a nice face, you have to have a beautiful, body. There are survivors who got married and then they got, acid attacks, and some of the families, their in-laws, they, they ask them to, they throw the those acid attack survivors out of their families. So yeah, definitely there is a difference. And coping also, society is more accepting for the male survivors, and majorly their marriage also happens sometimes because they are male again, and female has to go a lot of things. She has to isolate herself. Most of the girls, used to cover their faces, but again, coming to our organization, they have stopped doing it. There is this girl called Anshu, and she was just 16 or 15, and she was acid attacked. Now, coming back to this, coming to this organization, she started working on herself. She's good at public speaking, and now she's working also. She has done TED Talks also, and she's speaking so nicely, and she's working on herself, running her family. She comes from a very, very rural area where people are very, strict about female doing work, and they're not very, feminist in nature. So she has been a kind of a great example for all the girls there. So I think yeah, people are like, all these girls are kind of inspiration, even to me. You know, I'm working here, and the reason why I'm working here, because whenever I feel lower, whenever I feel that, you know, my life is not doing very nicely and I'm not doing very good in my life, I see them, you know, waking up every day and they're working hard to earn and to live their life. So I'll just give a little introduction about everybody who's present here. We have with us Mr. Ajit. Ajit sir is actually one of the board directors of our organization. And he is also heading a lot of other departments, such as education and training and also hiring. Other than that, we also have our team Shiro's. We have Anshu with us, and she is... So Anshu is actually, she's working from Cafe Agra, and also she's heading the reach out department, and she helps the reach out department to reach many other survivors and help them to get the treatment. Anshu is heading that. We have with us Ritu. Ritu is one of the oldest team members, and she is actually working as a PR also here, and she is heading communications with the survivors, and also, you know, she's been working since 2014, so she's also works as a word of mouth and face of the campaign. Also, have Pramodni with us. Pramodni ji is from Orissa, and she's been there since a long in the organization, and she is in Orissa and looking after, you know, spreading the campaign there, in, you know, staying there in Orissa. She's been vocal about this Stop Acid Attack campaign, and she's heading there, and she's reaching out to many other survivors and propagating this idea of acid ban in Orissa. Yeah. So I just will check again. We also have Mr. Ashish. He is the managing director of Cha Foundation, and like I told you about, you know, the initial team who actually started this campaign. He is one of that. The part of the team, and he started, you know, channelizing the idea of, you know, sale and how to ban this acid sale and start working on this whole vivid campaign. We also have Alok sir, but right now he's not present here because he's busy with some other meetings, and he has some bit of the engagement. So yeah, all of us are here, and we can start possibly with the proceedings. If anybody wants to say anything, they can possibly do that.
Ashish, how did you become involved in the campaign, and what's your part or what's your role in the Cha Foundation?
It's a very long story, and it's very organic, because I didn't aware about the issue is more effective. So 2013, before 2013, I met Alok, and Alok was a journalist, and that time he told me that I want to raise this issue in mainstream media. So can you bring with me? So the 8 March 2013, we started a campaign. It's called Stop Acid Attack. That time I completed my graduation in mass communication. So that's that's a journey.
Hi ladies, it's lovely to have you with the Digest. Thank you so much for agreeing to share your experience. I hope we can bring a lot of attention to your cause. Now, from my point of view, I can't imagine how on a day when everything was going as normal as far as you were concerned, suddenly you suffer a violent, life-changing moment. What happened on the day that you were attacked?
Hi,
Pramodni.
So when I was 16 years old, so I got acid attack. When I was studying 12, stay near my college, so one army man, he was in 28 years old. So he saw in my college. So there's after that. He proposed to my family. So my family straightly know it's because of just like I was 16 years old. So he ordered because he want to marry me. So I don't agree with his proposal. After that, he attacked me.
How well did you know the person before he proposed?
Actually,
she wasn't aware of that person and why he was staying, and she had no contact. But after she got acid attacks, and there was a legal procedure that, you know, started happening to, you know, see this case and who was the person and all that legal part was happening, she got to know that who that person was and what was his background. It was 2012 when she was attacked, and her cousin brother attacked her by giving 1.25 lakh to a group of people who actually attacked Ritu while she was going to her stadium to play volleyball. The person who attacked was 39 years of age and she was just 17. The whole attack scene, there were 18 people involved, in which there was one lady as well, heading towards her stadium to play her sport. And her cousin brother attacked. She was 15 when she was attacked, and she was attacked by a 55-year-old man who actually wanted to woo her and to marry her. There was his her neighbor who was interested in Anshu and wanted to, you know, get married with her, and she was just 15, so it was a vast age difference, and obviously Anshu was not interested. And when she said no, when her family said no, he attacked Anshu.
And how long did it take after you refused the proposal for them to attack you?
After 1 week of the rejection, it all happened. Why? Because Anshu's parents went to that man's house and, you know, to talk about everything. He attacked Anshu in all that anguish and anger.
What about getting used to the idea? How long did it take for you physically and mentally to accept what had happened and fully grasp that this would affect the rest of your life?
It is very challenging, you know, mentally, physically, in whichever way you ask. What happens sometimes, family members, they refuse to accept the survivors. They tend to, you know, pass on comments that this might be your fault and you are girls. This is the repercussions of your behavior or something. Societal pressure, and then you don't get support from your family. So it all turned into a difficult phase, which is mentally torturing. Anshu's parents were very supportive. They have backed her throughout her journey. Even Pramodini's mother is very supportive, and now her husband is very supportive. And even Ritu's family is very supportive. So it's fortunate that their families are supportive. You know, when you talk on the larger scale, there are so many survivors whose family, they have been thrown out by their families, their relatives, they pass on comments. So mentally, they have to see a lot of changes, which is not very accepting and which is not very comfortable to accept, actually. You completely change, your identity completely changes. And then on the top of it, you receive so many bad comments from the society that don't accept. And also, Pramodini mentioned that after joining the organization, from the support of the organization, it was all, you know, a healthy family that they developed. So this is what all Pramodini said, yeah.
So then the survivors, along with the foundation, became like a support group for each other.
So even if they do get support from the family, they are also clueless that what you have to do, how you have to mentally uplift them, you know. And they themselves are going through a tough time because they are seeing their child, you know, going through a lot of difficult phase. So they don't know. They have seen, you know, how a child takes birth and how they have to raise them. This is something, a natural process that they know, and they have been hearing about it through the society or their parents and everything, but then they have never seen somebody, you know, attacked by an acid. So that whole process is difficult difficult to the family also, you know, how to deal with it and how to actually give moral and mental support, mental counseling. So for that, such organization is important, wherein, you know, you have a particular designated person who actually know how to treat people mentally and how to make them aware of things and how to, you know, uplift their morale. She had a small house wherein there were two rooms only, and she was locked. She locked herself in one room wherein she didn't want to meet anybody. And her father was working too hard to make the ends meet. financially also it was a difficult time, mentally, physically, financially. So but even if you get support from your family, you need to have medical counseling, mental counseling, and that happens within the organization. That when she joined Chha Foundation, she saw that there are certain survivors who don't have to both of the eyes, like they have lost complete, they are completely blind, they just can feel that it is day or night, they can't see things, they are just feeling things, right? And when she got to know that I am blessed enough to see from one eye, she got to understand that yeah, there is still life, there are things that she can pursue. So because joining this organization, she got such people, she got to meet such people. So it all got together and they all got support from each other, and definitely it got uplifted, and they are doing whatever they feel like abhi, and they are quite happy, I hope.
मतलब गवर्नमेंट
व्हेन शी वाज रेफर्ड टू अवर हॉस्पिटल यू नो मेंटली शी वाज वेरी वीक यू नो एंड देन शी गॉट टू नो अबाउट शाह फाउंडेशन एंड व्हेन शी मेट आशीष एंड मिस्टर आलोक देन शी गॉट टू नो दैट यू नो द सपोर्ट एंड द काइंड ऑफ काउंसलिंग द काइंड ऑफ बैग दैट दे हैव गिवन मेड हर रियलाइज दैट शी इज वर्थ एंड शी इज वर्थ लिविंग स्टिल एंड शी कैन थ्राइव एंड यू नो शी यूज्ड टू कवर हर फेस एंड शी यूज्ड टू अवॉइड गोइंग एंड मीटिंग people, but now she attends, you know, she goes and gives interviews, and she goes for TEDx, and she goes and, you know, meets people, give interviews, and also, you know, she goes to Labasna, where there is she gives a training to IAS, and she gives speech to IAS aspirants and IAS officers. So it was all a whole lot of journey that happened because she got support from the right people and from the right set of individuals who are actually working on this issue. So she's actually kind of happy that she has joined, you know, Shaf Foundation since start. Yeah.
माता पिता या जो भी मतलब जितनी केयर कर सकते हैं उन्होंने मुझे दिया.
As this is such a visual thing and people's natural curiosity makes them stare, there are constant reminders that you have to live with on a daily basis. And so how difficult is that to cope with? And how does that make you feel?
मुझे लगता है कि
this definitely a difficult phase altogether. You know, completely your personality changes, your face changes. You tend to, you know, it is not very easy to accept yourself like that. You know, once she saw herself in the mirror, and there was no hope left to her to be, you know, continue her life. It was so difficult to see herself like that. She is also telling about one incident wherein she, with her friends, and also one of her friend from, you know, America, was here to visit her, to visit Shiro's, was here in Agra. You know, he was visiting Taj, so he was going back, like they all of them were going back to their hotels, and there was a rickshaw puller who was asking them to, you know, to lend him their rickshaw and to carry them to the hotel, but they refused, like they didn't want to do a rickshaw because it was just a walking distance. So that rickshaw puller said, by seeing Ritu, that it because you do all these things, na, that is why you've been attacked by us. So people do comment such things, and Ritu is saying that it did bother when she was young and when it was initial time, but now when she has, you know, completed a journey of 9 years post attack, she see it as a mental problem. It is not her problem. If you are commenting like that, it is your problem. It is not bothering. It is not bothering Ritu. It is not bothering Pramodi. They have done so much in their life that they are content now, and people around them mostly give them respect. They treat them with a happy face, and they accept them because it is not their fault. You know, being acid attacked was not their fault. It was somebody who was mentally ill attacked them. It was nowhere their fault, and now they are able. They are earning. They are living their life with head held high. It's all good and fine for them. It is still there. Like people, if they go out, people do give a stare. People do, you know. Maybe some people are there who come and talk to them, you know, make them comfortable. So there is a mix of society, and it will still be there. But now they are content with the fact that they are doing good in their life. So it is not bothering. But yeah, in the initial phase, it was difficult time.
So, ठीक है, मतलब अभी normal लगता है.
मेरे साथ ऐसा था कि
शी वॉज इन कोमा फॉर 9 years. शी कुडंट यू नो एक्चुअली सी हर सेल्फ थ्रू आउट द प्रोसेस ऑफ यू नो सर्जरीज एंड एवरीथिंग. देयर वर पीपल यू नो हु वर कमेंटिंग एंड ऑल्सो सेइंग थिंग्स टू हर मदर एज वेल. सो आफ्टर 9 long years शी कुड सी हर सेल्फ. शी वॉज ऑल कवर्ड एंड नाउ शी कैन सी फ्रॉम वन आई. इट वॉज ऑल डिफिकल्ट टाइम फॉर हर. But now when she, after 9 years, when she saw herself in the mirror, it was all accepting because she gotten strong because of the society, because of all the comments that were, you know, given to her. She had support of her family. Her mother was a, you know, a strongest pillar that she had. And also, you know, the organization helped her. Counseled her, and also she's saying a very beautiful thing that, you know, if there are 10 people who passes wrong comments, but there are 100 people who love this space. So she's saying that there always be, in any case, not only in the case of acid attack survivors, but in any case, there are people who will pull you down, but there are people who will support you. So she believes in the people who support her, and there are people who love her completely. And she has a family of, I think, 80,000 plus, you know, followers on Instagram and other platforms. And she's been loved by many people. And both of them, I mean, be it Ritu and Pramodi, they have been called for fashion shows. They have been called for events wherein they have been the jury of something. They are now taking classes. They are learning languages. You can see they are talking a little bit in English. And they're, you know, they are, Pramodini is married, and I hope Ritu soon will be married if she wants to. And yeah, so these are the things, and they are working. And I think they're heading their life just like a normal human being, and it's totally fine. And yeah, we also learn a lot of things. I told you earlier only that I learned so much things. Like, I'll tell you something about Ritu that she's so particular about. She has OCD and she has to clean everything. Like, when you visit our rehabilitation center, she manages it all so well. Like, even if you put a glass somewhere which is not designated place, she'll make your life miserable because she loves cleanliness so much, and she's always into that. Pramodini, on the other hand, is fun to watch. She makes, you know, she earlier used to make TikTok, but now it is banned in our country. But now she makes reels. She gives motivational, you know, she makes motivational reels and try to educate people through that and spread positive vibes. There are so many people want to talk to them, and when they are in depression or when they are failing in their life, because they have done so much. So yeah, that is how it all got into the cycle, and I also take so much inspiration from them.
What did you know about acid attacks before it happened to you?
She was not aware about acid. She haven't heard before her attack what was acid, and it was, you know, it was, she never imagined this can be a chemical that can spoil your life. So after the attack only she got to know that this is something that, you know, ruins the life and also being used in the household. She never knew while, you know, getting education or maybe in her classes, she never knew that what acid was. But in her, you know, in her locality, where in her village, there was this guy. Actually, I told you now that, you know, in India, most of the cases why, you know, acid was also used as a toilet cleaner, because a toilet cleaner or pipeline cleaner. So in her locality, there was, after the attack, she remembered this thing, that there was one day when there was a vendor who was just crossing the locality and he was selling acid. In Hindi, it is called tezab. So she wasn't aware that it is also called acid in English. So she got to know that, she remembered in the hospital when she was there that, okay, this is acid, a bottle of acid that he was selling. And he poured down onto the ground, and it was all, you know, it was all boiling. It was all just, you know, churning. So yeah, so I mean, most of them, they don't know what was acid now because of, and there was also no laws. Nobody talked about acid attacks. So not in the media or in the, you know, newspapers or just as a talk of it. Nobody used to talk about acid attacks.
And what happened to your attacker?
Mere case mein, 2.5 years ke baad,
as there were 18 people who were involved in her attack, three of them were also, you know, got a bail and they were out.
after 2.5 years, and amongst five of them, so like two of them got, you know, lifelong imprisonment order from the court, and three of them got 10 year jailed sentence from the court, but even she didn't got any application, or she didn't got any form from the High Court or Supreme Court that, you know, they have got these sentence. After 5 years, they were all on bail, and they are free now, and all the sentence and all the things that have been done, they are free. They are roaming here and there, and they are not in the jail. So because they were powerful people and they got some money, so they are free now. They all are free now.
मतलब देख लीजिए तो मुझे नहीं पता था अभी वो बाहर है सब तो.
मेरे केस में ये था कि मैंने
जब व्हेन शी वाज हॉस्पिटलाइज्ड हर मदर फाइल्ड हर कंप्लेंट एंड बिकॉज़ ही वाज अ पार्ट ऑफ आर्मी तो ही नो डॉज्ड इट एंड पुलिस सेड दैट देयर इज नो सच मैन विद दिस नेम देयर इज नो सच मैन इन ऑन अर्थ विद दिस नेम एंड इट वाज समथिंग करप्शन दैट दैट ही दैट पर्सन डिड बट आफ्टर 9 years व्हेन यू नो प्रमोदनी गॉट बैक शी कुड सी अ बिट But she reopened her case and she tweeted about her case, you know, tagging the CM of her state. He got attention to it, and this is now the case is still active, and he is in the jail. The person who attacked Modi is in jail. The case is like unbailable. He cannot get bail on this. So abhi, right now he has not got complete, you know, this thing, the sentence or anything from the court. But yeah, the case is still pending and also running in the court.
मैंने case reopen किया. अभी तक case court में case चल रहा था, hearing चल रहा था. अभी तक कुछ jail पे है.
ज्यादा कुछ तो नहीं बोलूंगी, बस मुझे हंसी आती है. मतलब
she laughs sometimes when she remembers her attacker and she pity her because the motive with which he attacked Ritu, that he's going to spoil her face, he's going to spoil her life. But now what that attacker must be seeing is Ritu is performing so great, he's coming on television, he's like, she's being a part of a, you know, major Bollywood movie that is made on this campaign and on her, and she's been acted. She also acted in that movie, Chapak. She has done another movie, which is Akira, with one of the Bollywood celebrity. It is him who is just sitting and nobody knows about him. And if they know about him, they're all, you know, saying bad things to him. Even Ritu is actually living her life to the fullest, though it was a difficult journey. No matter how hard you try to spoil somebody's life, anybody who is living will thrive, will succeed, will work for their life, and especially girls like her will definitely succeed because they believe in themselves and they will do whatever it will take to, you know, get what they wish for, and they will learn and they will survive. This is what Ritu says, and I love you, Ritu.
So matlab wo fail hai sab kuch, matlab kuch bhi nahi kar sakte.
जो लोग ऐसा करने के लिए जो
इन इंडिया देयर इज स्टिल इनइक्वालिटी इज प्रिवेलिंग, यू नो, दे लुक डाउन अपॉन विमेन एंड दे थिंक दैट देयर एवरीथिंग इज ऑन देयर फेस एंड नथिंग बियॉन्ड दैट, यू नो, इफ दे विल स्पॉइल देयर फेस एवरीथिंग विल कम डाउन टू एन एंड. बट देयर आर सो मेनी पीपल हु कैन इजिली पॉइंट आउट ऑन द लूपहोल्स दैट दिस इज नॉट देयर इन द कंट्री, दिस इज नॉट देयर. व्हाट एज एन इंडिविजुअल वी आर डूइंग नथिंग. इफ शी इज सेइंग दैट इफ there have been no such group of, you know, journalists who had this idea to set up in society and accepting society for acid attack survivors and to speak for this cause. They could have also been there and, you know, started pointing on the government that they're not doing anything, but they came into the picture, they started working themselves, they created this organization that has been rehabilitating more than 100 survivors, and that they're creating job opportunities, educating them and trying to empower them by giving them job opportunities and stable life. So she's saying that like Ritu said, she's also saying that her survivor must be sitting like in the jail and must be reading newspaper, and she here is living her life to the fullest. She loves her face, she loves all the people who are, you know, supporting her.
he got like she got a very beautiful husband. He's very supportive, and they dated for a couple of time, and he's also very supportive. And then they got married, and it's been 4 months. And her marriage was, you can also, you know, you can also Google if you want it, and the videos and all are very cute. And we also love them both together. And she's saying that if you want to change something, you have to come down into the picture and start doing something for it, rather just point out to the society or to the government or to the people in power.
मतलब कुछ नहीं है, दो लाइन है, क्योंकि मेरी लाइफ में
सो रितु इज एक्चुअली सेइंग दैट यू नो इन हर लाइफ ऑब्वियसली पेरेंट्स डिड गिव लॉट ऑफ सपोर्ट टू हर, बट स्पेशली मिस्टर आलोक एंड मिस्टर आशीष आर काइंड ऑफ अ गॉड टू हर, बिकॉज दे एक्चुअली यू नो केम डाउन इन फॉर्म ऑफ गॉड, एंड लाइक द काइंड ऑफ हेल्प एंड सपोर्ट दैट दे ऑफर टू हर was something that that she never expected and except like it is something exceptional to her, and she really she wants to thank her, and she's just sweet. She wants to thank the organization to give her the platform, you know, wherein she can see all the colors that she's having in her life and can paint her canvas that way. Yeah,
बहुत बड़ा thanks है मेरी life में ये role play कर. और मुझे
झा फाउंडेशन केम एज अ चैनल टू एक्चुअली ब्रिंग आउट दिस सच इम्पोर्टेंट इशू ऑन द लार्जर लेवल, नॉट जस्ट इन द कंट्री बट ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, बिकॉज नाउ पीपल आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस इशू इन इंडिया एंड एल्सवेयर एज वेल, एंड यू नो पीपल इन पावर आर ऑल्सो टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस इशू, इज जस्ट बिकॉज यू नो समवेयर इन दिस कंट्री देयर वर ग्रुप ऑफ पीपल हु वर एक्चुअली thinking about this issue, and they did something for this issue. So all together, everybody is happy, and they are just being sweet and thanking this organization. But I think this is just an overall effort of every individual who is associated with this organization, and every lady here is just a power pack individual. They have so many inspirational. When you talk, I hope I was able to, you know, translate whatever the intensity with which they were saying things. But yeah, they all are amazing people. And when the lockdown was there, everybody was, you know, even our cafe got a very difficult time, and you know, we were not able to receive any form of funds through the cafe, because we believe in self-sustainability. But still, you know, survivors came with an idea, team members of Shiro's, that why not, you know, they say they saw so many people on roads, on slums, you know, waiting for somebody to give food packets, because they were sleeping hungry because they were locked down in an entire country. So they came up with the idea, why not open the cafe? Even we were going through a financial crunch. And they started running this Shiro's food drive, wherein they are making food packets and delivering it to the people in need. And they are giving it to the children in slums. They are giving it to the people who are working as a laborer or migrant laborers. So they are doing that. And for that, they also need support from the people. So if that can be possible, that is great. They want to help other people as well. But thank you so much, Andy, for setting up this need. And I hope it will help us also to propagate this cause to a larger level, and you can inform a lot of people about this.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Thank you so much. Have a good
That's
day.
That's great. Everybody. And you too. Thank you, ladies. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Much appreciated.
Bye-bye.
Cheers. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you want to contribute to the Chan Foundation, you can do so by holding your phone camera to this. And if you'd like more information on the Shiro's Hangout, you can go here. And this is the website for the Chan Foundation. Once again, many thanks for watching. Please subscribe and share the video as much as you possibly can. It's a truly worthwhile cause, and we want to give it as much publicity and attention as possible.